Common Core standards, let's go to our first slide. The history of Common Core comes from 2010, when the National Governors Association and the Council of State School Officers recognized that there was an opportunity to improve standards for all schools. They leveraged the expertise and experience of educators across the 48 states. They listened to what the governors and the governors listened to what business owners and different public members said about our students not being prepared. They listened to test results that are nationwide. They reviewed concerns and they decided to recreate the standards so that way we had more of a commonality as students moved because we are such a transient society. Through the collaborative efforts of educators, we are able to work together more and more soundly. To date, 45 states, the District of Columbia, 4 territories, the Department of Defense Education Activity have all adopted the Common Core state standards. Common Core is not a curriculum. It is internationally benchmarked and it prepares students for the 21st century. It provides guidance and support to educators. It's a framework that we can work from, and there are end of the year goals per grade level. The Common Core standards are a floor, not a ceiling. Common Core standards include some different appendices. In math, there is one appendice. That is a pathway that shows for the K-5 grade levels an intense foundation that teachers can work from. Doesn't mean it's the only thing that they can do, but they can work from that as commonality. Also, the appendix allows us to have a common vocabulary. In grades 6 through 12, it talks about the vocabulary for applications. As an example, in geometry, we talk about different shapes, doing a flip or a rotation, but then they move, the children move on to the next grade level, and it's called something different. Or many of us can remember when we learned subtraction, everybody called it borrowing. Well, now it's regrouping. Well, if we have people using all these different terms, it's very confusing. So this allows us to have a common vocabulary. In English language arts, there are 3 different appendices. Appendix A has a very nice glossary once again, so we have common vocabulary. Appendix B has text exemplars, and they also list some sample performance tasks. Here's just a few of the books. I just quickly grabbed a few of the books that are on the list within that appendix. And all of the books here, we can choose to use, we can choose to not use. A teacher can say, I'm going to use this one in my class because this is what we need at that time. So if it fits the ability of the children and it fits the culture of the classroom, they can use it. If it doesn't fit, or the teacher does not think it's appropriate, they don't need to use it. These are not the only things listed that they have to use. They have free choice to use whatever they need. And then the last appendix, appendix C, are student examples of writing, because we need to be writing in many forms to have the children experience as much as they possibly can. In language arts, the Wisconsin Model Academic Standards were written in the 1990s, and these were our old standards and the standards that we were using. They were only 6 broad standards telling students what they needed to know and be able to do, and they were on grades 4, 8, and 10 only. So if you taught kindergarten to third grade, you had to sort of make up and get to that fourth grade standard. If you taught fifth, sixth, and seventh grade, you were sort of, well, maybe we should do this in order to get the kids to the eighth grade. And And the same for ninth grade teachers, but then the 11 and 12 teachers didn't even have standards to follow at the time. So then along came Common Core, and here we're asking our students to analyze, we're asking students to delineate, to integrate, and to interpret. Much more thought is going into what the children are being asked to do. There are over 40 standards that are clearly organized by grade level, and they define exact skills and understandings, once again, that we're asking the students to do. Our timeline for Wisconsin shows that in 2008, a task force was made. There they saw those 1990 standards were outdated and we needed so much more for our students. We expected more of our students. We expected more of our educators. So the task force was formed. In spring of 2010 was the first public release of our standards. So we could look at them and the public was able to respond what they liked, what they didn't like. Then in June of 2010, Tony Evers accepted them and adopted them, and along with that adopted the new testing, which is Smarter Balanced. And the Smarter Balanced assessment also includes formative, interim, and summative assessments. And we will look at a few of those examples. And lastly, as I have been reading through, Thomas Foreham Foundation just stated that they estimate that Wisconsin experienced one of the highest jumps in rigor from our old standards, only 4th, 8th, and 10th grade, to the new standards we adopted as the Common Core. And here's just a chart of the Wisconsin's adoption. You can see that in 2010 and 11, DPI and our CESAs did quite a bit of studying. Then it came down to the local schools being able to choose their curriculum and aligning their resources. Then currently we're in the implementation phase, and then when we get to next school year, they're asking for full implementation of English language arts and of math, because in the spring of 2015 will be our first administration of the Smarter Balanced assessment. English language arts, we have some critical content areas that must be taught and must be read through. So that will include our classic fables and stories. It's going to include America's founding documents. It's going to include American literature, Shakespeare, and any other novel or text that the teacher sees as appropriate for their class. Now, also, it includes much on informational text. The informational texts don't have to be taught only in an English language arts class. They can also be taught in a history class, in a science class, in a social studies class, in a technology class, in a home ed class. Those are where we're preparing students for other forms of work. So they need to know, how is it that I read through some of these intense manuals? And if they're getting that information from an instructor who has studied that, then they're going to get the right information. As an English teacher, I'm not going to know how to read and apply the information in a technical or mathematical manual, but our tech teachers and our computer teachers, they certainly are going to understand it and be able to explain it way better than an English teacher could. Okay, this just shows simply the breakdown of the grade levels of the difference between reading and literacy and informational. And clearly, as students are young, there's a 50-50 spread. And as students get older, that informational text is asked to be 70% of their schooling. That doesn't mean that's English class. That means all their other classes, they're getting that information on how to read, how to become a historian, how to write like a historian, etc. But in that English class, 30% of their time is on intense novels and classics. And then the second graph shows the amount of writing that students are doing. We want them to be doing much more persuasion, much more explanation, and lots of conveying. These numbers are suggested. They are not required. They are suggested. Okay, now I have a couple of examples of different standards themselves. The first one is a grade one standard in English language arts. And this shows books written by the same author and students showing their understanding of characters, setting, problems, solution, and ending. So they're learning all the different story elements and looking at the differences that are in, that have been made by the same author. So this is one sample and one way that this teacher chose to have the children learn about this standard. Multiple ways you can do it. This is just one example. Next is the middle one there is a standard for grade 7. And this is a student sample of the book Little Women, where on one side they're showing this is what it is in the book as compared to the movie. The book, the movie. So they're making all of these comparisons. They also tell you that the book was written in 1868, so they're studying some of the history of that time period. They're getting to know the characters very well. And they're also studying about poverty. They're studying about the Civil War at the time, because they talk about the father being gone. So there's a lot of history that's being pulled into that English language arts story. The last example up there of a standard comes from grade 10. And in that standard, it is asking for analyze how the author's choice is part of the structure of a text. So if I had To Kill a Mockingbird as an English teacher, after we have read it and we have studied it and we understand the time period, et cetera, et cetera, so we have all the background, I could choose to have my students, based on your knowledge of the book's time period, the culture and acceptance during that time, develop a 5-paragraph essay explaining your understanding of the author's choice regarding the pacing of the story, the order of events, and the elements of surprise. That's something I could choose to do. I could say we're going to do something else to meet that standard, but we're going to look at the standard intensely. At this time, I have a few teachers that have agreed to speak and tell you how they are using Common Core in their classrooms. So Mary Waite, she had planned to be here, but it is her daughter's cross-country banquet, and she cannot come. But her principal, Mr. Brewer, is going to speak for her tonight.
Well, thank you, Gayle. I just want to say thank you to everybody who showed up this evening. This is one of the more full houses I've seen in my 3 years here at Northland Pines, and it's touching because it's about education, which is what we're about. It's not about some of the other things that we have seen in front of us before. So thank you to everybody showing up. Again, Mary Waite is not here this evening. She is at a cross-country banquet for her daughter today, but she did pass along a few things with that. But I do want to touch base before I get into some of Mary's stuff. You know, the Common Core standards are basic competencies. They're not the full curriculum from a state or local district. You know, and again, it is basic competencies. And standards have been around for quite some time. I'm a history teacher by trade. Gayle gave us some. President Eisenhower in 1959 discussed the creation of national goals for education. From there, we have moved on. You know, for example, in 1983 with a nation at risk, came out, which basically said we needed higher standards to compete with other countries. In 1988, you had Senator Kennedy and President Reagan collaborate to create the National Assessment of Educational Progress, a close relative to national standards. In 1989, you had President George H. Bush oversee the development of a voluntary national standard system. And then in 2001, you had No Child Left Behind, which, you know, kind of moves us in a direction of more assessment and accountability. So we've had standards for quite some time. We've been operating with standards, Wisconsin standards, as Gayle had mentioned, you know, since I've been in education. And so the standards, having standards is not new. And it's not a brand new idea just brought up by the governors and education folks creating the common standards. But Some of the things that I've seen here at Northland Pines that Mrs. Waite mentioned as well is the Common Core State Standards, and this is Mary Waite saying this, have provided us with a vehicle for discussing and analyzing what we are teaching and why we are teaching it. And it truly has done that. I've seen that in the English Language Arts Department here at the high school, where they have come together to discuss what it is that they're teaching and why it is that we're teaching. Those critical conversations have taken place, and the Common Core State Standards is one avenue of why that has happened. As a result of that, okay, they have raised the bar in the classes. She gives a couple examples. They teach Harper Lee's classic novel to freshmen instead of sophomores now. As a result of that, the seminal U.S. documents that have been traditionally taught in American literature, which has taken place during their junior year, have been moved to English too, which students take their sophomore years. So the level of complexity for kids has gone up, and that's because of the formulation of these standards and looking at these standards and seeing what we can do for our kids locally here at Northland Pines. Okay. We decide how we teach to those standards. We decide what we use to teach those. It is up to us to do that locally with that, and I've seen that. Like I say, as they've gone through this, they've also have seen that it's not a huge change from what we have been doing. According to her, in our analysis of existing curriculum, we have found that we already are meeting many of these standards and are already doing everything that is there. She even estimated that in their junior English course, it revealed that 90% of what they have already been done are touched in the standards. So it's not anything new that's truly coming out. However, it is raising the bar for our students in that regard. They said they have found few gaps, few overlaps, and have had many opportunities to collaborate with colleagues within our own schools, between districts, and across states, okay, which has not happened in the past, which I think is only beneficial to our students here at Northland Pines.
Thank you so much. As I have met with that particular group of teachers, as we have gone through the new standards compared to our old standards, and we found very, very few that we were not addressing. So they will be addressed now, so that way then the children receive that full education. So thank you so much. And Mrs. Pokrant.
Becky Polkrant. I'm the 8th grade English Language Arts teacher at Northland Pines Middle School. I am in my 32nd year of teaching, and I can honestly say that for the first time in 32 years, teachers have come together. Teachers are working together as teams, and they're willing to put forth the effort to bring Common Core, all of the standards, to the children in the best way possible. To me and the students, it's a very exciting time in education. With Common Core standards, the guide for how to become uniform and consistent in nature has come forward in the field of education. Teachers have a measurable tool for self-accountability and an end goal. Students have an opportunity to receive new rigor. Not just rigor, but new rigor. Challenges that are going to take them beyond the paper, pencil, seat work into the 21st century. As an 8th grade English language arts teacher, I became immersed in the Common Core over the past couple years. There were a lot of new buzzwords with the initiative, a lot of new approaches and styles to teaching that all educators needed to embrace. As part of an English language arts team at the middle school, we got together, we collaborated, and all of us embraced the opportunity to make our department much more exciting, more challenging, and improve with that rigor as it was coming down for us. Northland Pines Middle School English Language Arts Department consists of 3 teachers, 6th, 7th, and 8th grade. Our opportunity was, for the first time since I've actually been in that department, to all come together, feel like we are on a team, and all have the same end goal in sight. We were able to do that by creating a Northland Pines Middle School Balanced Literacy document, a document that would be available for parents, the board, other staff, and the community to have a better understanding of what our Common Core expectations would be for our students and our families in the district. Last year, I had an opportunity to be trained through CESA 9 with the Common Core Curriculum Companion. This was an opportunity to come together with teachers from other districts in the CESA 9 area and learn about this tool, which would allow us to take our training back to our staff and all, again, collaboratively work together to immerse and embed our Common Core standards into this tool. Curriculum Companion is a K-12 tool. The focus of the Curriculum Companion has four enduring understandings that are sequenced with increasing sophistication from the beginning of the year to the end. Within these understandings, students learn how to collaborate with peers and become self-directed learners. They work hard to foster a stronger understanding of the human experience connections within their reading and their writing. They use a variety of thinking strategies to accomplish analyzing, understanding, creating text for personal enrichment, inquiry and problem solving, and comprehension. They are taught to cite evidence upon which they base questions, construct arguments, make decisions, and are open-minded in their thinking. Through research and inquiry, they obtain, analyze, and synthesize information. These are strategies that are not new to education, but many of them are new to our students. Because in the past, these were strategies that the teachers used and imposed upon the children. Now, we plant the seeds and we allow the students to grow as we lay out these strategies for them to learn and utilize. That's the new rigor that we're talking about. Through several sessions of getting together with the 612 English Department of Northland Pines and working together, collaborating and training amongst ourselves, we unpacked the Curriculum Companion. We were able to embed into that tool our curriculum, our lessons, our performance tasks, our assessments, to make it be united and consistent across the board for our students. Within weeks of last year's school year, the 2012-13 school year, within weeks of that year's start, I was witness to something new and creative happening in my classroom. The thinking that was going on, the light bulbs that were going on, was very exciting. Best practice strategies were implemented in all lessons, and the students were utilizing those best practices. Increased exposure to literature, both fiction and nonfiction, was occurring. A stronger culture of readers was emerging right before my eyes, right before the students' own eyes. Students were aspiring to reach a literature challenge. An updated classroom library was also a wonderful source for them to take ownership. These students were allowed the opportunity to choose the literature that was of interest to them, to choose the literature that they wanted to grow from. Being aware and involved through literature choices promoted a sense of ownership, a sense of pride for these students aspiring to reach the literature challenge. As the awareness for literature was expanding, so also was the students' writing, because we do know that reading and writing go hand in hand. Students were able to have a solid transfer of knowledge and application of the Common Core standards while being met all at the same time. Confidence was on the horizon for these students. In my classroom, I follow a GRR model. The GRR model stands for Gradual Release of Responsibility. By design, I transition from assuming all of the responsibility for performing a task to having the students, if I could do this without papers, I would, to a situation where the students assume all of the responsibility. It mentors students into becoming capable thinkers and learners. The GRR model is an efficient approach for improving writing achievement, reading comprehension, and literacy outcomes for all English language arts students. The model itself would follow, as the teacher, I show them how I would do it. Then, together, the students and I show that we can do it. I step back and I say, you can do it, and they show me how. And eventually, it's an independent process where then the student takes ownership to fulfilling the task. Through this model, in my classroom on a daily basis, you will see teaching, mentoring, collaborating, facilitating, and independent thinking going on. This is what Common Core has provided our students to achieve. This model has become very popular, not only in my classroom, but across the nation. This model has been cited as being a very valuable model by a lot of the gurus in education. The best example that I can provide you with is a long-term project that my students and I embarked on last April. Teaching eighth grade language arts, I service over 100 students daily. These students embarked on a research and inquiry project for a current social problem. By using the model that I laid out and they worked together on in small groups, they developed a plan of action to reach an end goal. And that end goal was to research a current social problem and put together an exhibit which they would present to the general public last April at the first ever middle school social problems fair. The process included research, inquiry, analysis of data, developing a thesis or a platform, and collaborating to produce an exhibit. The intense labor by students researched and resulted into a 2-hour long fair of non-stop, constant flurry of activity of students presenting their social problems and their exhibit to a steady stream of other students, staff, parents, grandparents, board members, community members. This was fostered through the help of various community organizations who came in, spoke to the children, worked with them to allow them the opportunity to grow in their awareness and their research of these social problems. This was a result of the GRR model as well as the Common Core standards. All of the learning strands through Common Core, reading, writing, speaking, and listening, were addressed, and infused into that was the element of technology. This is just one of the many examples of what I've been able to experience with my students using the Common Core standard. I'm very excited about these opportunities. I know that there is a plethora out there of opportunities for any teacher, any student, in any classroom. And as I said earlier, it's an exciting time in education. It's a time for everybody to embrace change and the challenge and the rigor of education and what it has to offer. So thank you for the opportunity to speak, and I'll hand it back to Gayle.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it. And our last teacher for now is Ms. Nancy Foster, and she is a kindergarten teacher.
Hello. I started my career here 19 years ago teaching half-day kindergarten, so the changes I've seen over the last 19 years from half-day kindergarten, where we were basically play-based, to full-day kindergarten now with the Common Core, has been amazing. I just wanted to share with you why it's been so okay for us as elementary teachers, as kindergarten teachers. We started a standards-based report card about 10 years ago. We used those Wisconsin standards that Gayle mentioned before, and we decided we wanted more. We didn't want to just give that A grade, what might that mean, an A in math. So we rolled up our sleeves and we developed a standards-based report card. It was bumpy along the way. We had a lot of educating of parents and the kids and everybody, but it ended up being such an effective tool. As we then made the switch, now Common Core came along, and we went, hey, this is okay, because we know how to teach to the standards. We know how to meet the standards. We were never told you have to do this in a certain way, as we've all mentioned. We were told this is what the kids need to know by the end of the year. So we're able to come up with appropriate, developmentally appropriate activities to teach these. So I just wanted to share with you that really it's been such an easy transition for us because we are so aware of how to teach to the standards. As we got the new standards, a few of them were, oh, this is gonna be a little different, but it's been so fun to talk to other teachers. I'm on Twitter and I follow all these blogs, so every night I'm reading what other kindergarten teachers are doing. And I probably have way too much information, too many ideas. I have to scale it down and talk to my colleagues and say, how am I gonna do this? Because I wanna do this, 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 and that, and I can't spend that much time on geometry, for instance. So we really, the district, the team, that everybody has worked together so well to make this such an okay thing. And we have never been told this is what you have to teach. That's what's been so amazing about this. This is what the kids need to know. Go about it in the way that you as a professional think is going to be the best for the kids. So I think we've decided, we've always heard you can set the bar here and this is where the kids will come, they'll rise up to it. If you set it up here, you're gonna have a lot more rising up. So we have raised the bar, but we're proud of that and we're proud of what the kids have been able to accomplish. So even way down with the littlest kinders, it's been a great experience and we've seen so much. They have just proved that they can handle it. So it's been really worthwhile and love the collaborating, love working with colleagues that I might not have talked to about a certain topic because I figured they know what they're doing. So we talk, we share, and it's just been really, for me, a very fulfilling experience, and I like the challenge. It's been really exciting to see what's coming down. So
next I want to show you a few examples of what testing will look like on the new Smarter Balance assessment. You've heard about some of the standards. I've shown you a few examples. You've heard how some of the teachers are implementing it in the classroom. Well, the new Smarter Balance will be given in grades 3 through 11. And this is a grade 3 English language arts performance task. I think I have math on. All right, well, I'll show you the math one. This shows on the left side of the screen, the children are asked to read about a lemonade stand. It shows a paragraph of the sales in July. Then the kids need to come over here to the right side. They're reading, the bar graph shows how many cups of lemonade were sold in July, then they need to complete the graph. So it's not just do a problem and move on, but it's applying what they're seeing in the graph into another graph. And then on the next question is, how many total cups of lemonade did Jolene sell in July? So now they need to come back here, gather all of these numbers, and put them down for an answer. And then the next thing asks them to do some more reading. She sold lemonade for 4 weeks in August. She compares. So now they've got more work to do in comparing numbers, rereading that graph, putting it into another graph form. And yet there's still more to do. And this is all one question. Now they're going to use the information from the August to complete the next part. Here's where they need to also know picture graphs. If this is 4 cups, this is 10 cups, this is 20 cups, they have to fill this in based on the information off of the graph. Off of the graph, yes. So there's so many more compartments for the children to do. It's math now is much, much more than filling in worksheets and more worksheets. Yes, this has its place, but it's not just filling in worksheet after worksheet. Practice has its place, definitely. But we're moving more and more to the practical application. Students need to know how to read all of that information and then apply it. We're asking students to do much more problem solving, explaining their thinking, explaining their reasoning, and be able to put it into checking for reasonability. What is the answer? What exactly are you being asked? Are you sure you're answering the question that's being asked of you? So there's a lot for students that they have to do, and the new standards will help us get to that. Okay, So that's third grade. Then eighth grade, I think we will pull this up. Okay, so once again, on the left, they are reading, as here's the directions, Penny's argumentative performance task, the issue, they're reading, the directions for the beginning, research question, part one. They're reading more and more. They're giving you where the sources are coming from. They get done with all of this reading, and then they come over here to the right. And they have to provide three arguments from the sources that they were given. They have to now provide three arguments from the sources that support the position. So they're learning how to support and find the opposite. They're learning how to, in the area of disputing an argument. So they need to be able to find both sides of an argument. So a lot more than where's the noun, where's the verb, what does the story mean? There's so much more we're asking of our students so they're better prepared. Foundational skills is the first part. In the elementary, we're looking at the four mathematical operations. So students need to know addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and not just of whole numbers, but of fractions as well. Then in the middle school and high school years, we're asking kids to do much more thinking and reasoning of mathematics. They're applying their different problems or situations to real world application, and there's much more depth of understanding. It's not just a dabble of different math problems, but really getting into what does it mean, how do you get there, explain how you got there. Now, we go into the standards. Many people say that in the Common Core, that Algebra 2 is the top in the Common Core, and Algebra actually, once the Common Core is fully implemented, Algebra will be an eighth grade level class for those students that are ready. Along with that, we can move students into Geometry and Algebra 2, and in our high school, we also offer Pre-Calculus, Calculus, Trigonometry, Stats and Probability, and Consumer Mathematics. Other schools around the country offer many more math courses, but that's what our school offers. Again, it's the floor, not the ceiling. It doesn't say you must stop at Algebra 2. You can go beyond that, and that's what our school district has chosen to do, is going beyond that. Okay, to pick just a few different grade levels of some different standards. Grade 2, partitioning of circles and rectangles. So here we have 7-year-olds that are going to be using fractions. I'm going to try to balance this. So you have your whole, so we've got the kids looking at the whole, but then they also have to know that 2 halves are equivalent, not just equal, but equivalent to the whole. They need to know that 3/3 are also equivalent to the whole. They need to know 4/4 are equivalent to the whole. But we also are asking them to know that 1/2 is also equivalent to 2/4. So there's so much more we're asking 7-year-old students to be able to understand and do. They're going to take this with not only a rectangle, but they're going to have circles, and they need to be able to understand that and explain it, that these two pieces equals this piece because 1/2 is equivalent to 2/4. And you see your 7-year-old saying that. That's what we're asking them to do now. The sixth grade standard talks about this here. We're asking students to be able to take this very easy problem and use distributive property. So 2 times 8 plus 2 times 7, and then multiply out as one way. They could do it that way. They could also choose to take the same problem and do 8 plus 7 and 8 plus 7. Either way is perfectly acceptable. Nowhere does it say you must do it just this one way. Either way is perfectly acceptable. And then the last example up there is of a high school standard. And that one, we can take 2 cans of soup. And this can be first learned in math, but then used in a home ec class, and then also pull in some language arts into it. Both cans are 10.75 ounces. They both have different prices. They're both the same product, but which one is the better deal? So we're going to ask the students to figure that out. We're also going to take the nutritional values and do a comparison with that. Which one is more healthy for you based on the information of the measurements in it, the grams, the ounces, the milligrams. So we're getting students more and more in depth of what they are doing. And then finally they'll say, well, let's do the taste test, because that's the most important thing for kids. They love to eat, so we'll taste test. We did receive an email from a concerned citizen, and they asked about our math classes and the higher level math classes. Well, you know, Common Core doesn't have all of these high level math courses because it does say that it stops at Algebra 2. Well, our math department got together and they said, well, we offer so much more. We expect more from our students. And they did come up with a statement, and I'm going to ask one of our math teachers if he would please read that for us.
Hi, I'm Steve Miller. I've been with the math department at the high school for the past 13 years. And here's our response to some of those questions. It's been reiterated several times that Common Core does not dictate what we use for curriculum. It only what we are tested on. The Common Core standards cover through Algebra 2, meaning we expect all of our students to be tested on the standards through Algebra 2. Algebra 2 is the gatekeeper course for students entering a university. I mean, if a student plans on attending a university, they can expect standards up to and including Algebra 2 to be on their entrance exams. And their transcript had better include Algebra 2. Some of the students applying to get into a university likely will want to go into a STEM field, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. At Northland Pines, those students usually take a pre-calculus and or calculus course. It would be amazing for us as math teachers if 100% of our students wanted to go into a STEM career field, but that's not very realistic. All students have different interests. That being said, not all NPHS students need to take pre-calculus or calculus course in the high school. What is exciting is since our standards have been raised, 6th through 12th grade in mathematics, more students feel confident to enter those honors courses. If we desired more students to enter a STEM field, we could require 4 credits of mathematics at the high school, which would prepare a larger portion of the student body for college calculus. But again, that decision wouldn't have anything to do with Common Core or any other state assessment. Whoever translated the highlighted statement to say that Common Core doesn't prepare students for STEM careers doesn't really understand what Mr. Zimba was trying to say. Our district's decision to prepare students for STEM is independent of how the state chooses to test us. It's obvious that students who choose a major STEM career field should take more math, just like it's obvious that a student who wants to play music should take more music classes. A few years ago, our department already made a conscious decision to help our students become better problem solvers by switching our curriculum to CPM. We focused on changing the style of our teaching to help our students be able to communicate mathematics more effectively and create more confidence in our students' ability to solve difficult problems. The change was challenging because our students were comfortable with rote memorization, not thinking and problem solving. This problem solving skill is exactly what students going into STEM careers will need. However, the Common Core state standards does not disrupt this problem solving skill. That skill is a function of how students are taught mathematics, which is independent of what they're required to learn.
What are math department is doing 6-12. I'd like to tell you about our math in grades K-5. This year we did purchase new math textbooks. Our old series, they were old, they were falling apart, and it was a lot of drill, worksheet. Again, at times it has its place, but there wasn't a lot of, do you understand? What does this mean? How can you apply it to other things? So after over a year, we had a group of teachers who volunteered to come in, and they did lots of research. They decided what it was that we wanted for our students, what our expectations were of our students, and we finally decided on this program called Envisions. And as you can see from the PowerPoint, Envisions does have math fact knowledge. We're asking the kids to know the math facts, of course. Lots of problem solving, lots of exploration. There's online components to it. There's literacy components to it. There's embedded practices of all the skills. And we also are having kids do whole group, small group, and individualized work. It's not just the teacher stand in front and take control all the time. Children are being asked to do more and more. Each sample that I'm showing you is the number one problem. I can't just randomly pick, and you cannot progress in the practice test until you've answered each question. So first off, here we have sixth graders. They're being asked, here's a cereal box. It's 12 by 8 by 2. But the manager wants a new size, but it still has to contain the same amount. So the students then have to take this information on the left and apply it on the right. They're going to find the volume. Then they need to here's the box taken apart, put the different dimensions within it. Then they're going to determine the surface area based on that. And then the company proposes a new box, and there are the new dimensions. The new cereal box is a rectangular prism, so they better know that terminology. They have to determine if the new box meets each of the requirements, which are over here on the left, and then explain why or why not. Not just figure out the size, but explain why or why not is it going to work. And then one more part, design your box. Give your dimensions and explain how the box meets each of the requirements, again listed here on the left. So they're doing a lot of writing and explaining in their math class. There are 50 questions in this portion. Okay, here we have y equals x squared. Now, the students need to come on over here, grab a hold of the line, and change the line so it equals this new equation of y equals x minus 4 squared plus 2. And they can't advance to question 2 until they have answered that question. So if they don't know, they're done. They can't progress unless they guess. So that's why we insist that our students take higher level math. We want them to be there. We want them to be prepared. We want them to show that they understand. Okay, at North of Pines, we have taken our standards and unpacked them in the fall of 2010 for English Language Arts, and then the spring of 2011 school year for math. That fall, we distributed copies of the Common Core to each of our staff members. Then in the spring and summer of 2012, we started into the curriculum companion, as Mrs. Pokrant talked about. And then in the fall of 2012, we implemented English Language Arts K-12. All of our teachers started K-12 English Language Arts, which included the literacy standards for history, technology, science, social studies. And our teachers in those areas who know that content very well are teaching kids how to think like a historian, how to write like a scientist. And then this fall in 2013, we've implemented the K-12 curriculum, or Common Core curriculum. Okay, now I'd like to show you, you've seen all this stuff, how do you actually pull it together? Well, it can be kind of a great big puzzle at times, and this is how my version of quickly putting together a unit. And my unit is going to cover 6 different content areas and 17 different standards. So, first of all, reading. I'm going to choose, in my third grade classroom, we're going to read this book, Little House on the Prairie. It's a great book. It's got Wisconsin authors. There's a lot of history. There's a lot of culture and content in it. While we're reading it, we're going to learn the whole application of summarization. It's a hard concept for kids to understand summarization, but we're going to work on that. We're going to talk about story elements, we're going to do character development, and we're also going to talk about vocabulary enrichment. All important parts in reading. While we're doing the reading, we're also going to be working on language arts, because of course they go together. So we're going to be writing our summarization and working on all the different conventions. We're going to be using evidence from the text to support what we're stating, such as on page such and such, PA does. So we're going to use the evidence. And we're going to organize the events. Children have a tough time organizing events in the proper order. So that's something that we definitely will work on, and it's one of our standards. And then for math, we're going to learn about measurements of liquids, lengths, and weights. And it will all tie together. We're going to make equivalence, knowing that 2/2 equals a whole. We're going to make line plots that show that understanding. And we're also going to do some hands-on practice with different pieces. So we're going to pour things, how many cups fit into a quart, how many quarts fit into a gallon. We're going to actually get our hands on those things. Not just on a piece of paper, but get your hands on them so that way then they can see it. Oh, I remember that those fit into there. Then for science, we're going to use those three are all Common Core standards. But then when we go into science, we're going to use the Wisconsin Model Academic Standards because we are not using Common Core because they're not ready for us yet. So we're going to go to our Wisconsin standards. We're going to learn how to use equipment properly. We're going to work on collecting data in the right form. We're going to talk about science, or solids, liquids, and gases, and how we can change from one state of matter to another. We're going to predict changes and how all of those relate to real-world experiences. Then in history or social studies, we're also going to use our Wisconsin Model Academic Standards, because Wisconsin did not accept the Common Core Standards because they did not include enough behavioral sciences. So we're sticking with our Wisconsin standards because that's what we have. There we're going to investigate famous people in Wisconsin and the U.S. Laura Ingalls Wilder is a Wisconsinite, so we're going to do some author study on her. We're also going to talk about goods and services that were in that time period compared to now, because we want to know the differences then, now, and even what goods and services really are. And then in art, we're going to take and do the National Art Standards, and we're going to make a connection to visual arts. We're going to look at the difference between arts itself and academics and how they move together. So we'll have reading, we're writing. You guys are going to help me right here. And you're going to do the science experiment where you have to do some liquid measurement, and you're going to, because we don't have a butter churn like they had back then, but we do have a jar and it shakes. And once you make your butter, you can enjoy it on some crackers. Go for it. And then we couldn't be without a rag doll because Laura and Mary have rag dolls. So she needs her other bow and her buttons sewn on for her face piece. Okay? So we want the kids to get those things in their hands and start experiencing them. So it's not just pieces. It's a puzzle that all goes together. And when we give the teachers the freedom to get those standards, to know them and use the things that they know work best, it all blends together. Freedom Companion, and this is what Mrs. Polkrant talked about. This is an awesome, organized framework that ensures that all of our standards are addressed. It allows our teaching staff their full professionalism on decision-making for activities and resources and the assessments that they choose to use. Within the Curriculum Companion, as already said, we have 4 different overarching enduring understandings, or OEUs we call them. Within each of those OEUs, there are approximately 2 to 4 different modules that teachers are asked to cover. And in this one, we have three different modules. Module B is asking us to analyze the theme of story elements in language novels. It's estimating it should take 3 weeks, but in here it clearly states that the teacher is the one who's going to be pulling what books, what activities, what is the expectation for her students to do. She has posted, or he has posted in the classroom, the essential questions. These are the things we're really looking for answer, or having our students answer for us while we're doing this intense study. And then down here it shows the different strands. This whole framework allows us to take all of our things that we create, all of our resources we pull, and put them into it, so it makes a really nice organized framework for our teachers to continue to use, and they can change things freely. If they decide this just did not work at all, I'm going to make something different, they can upload that into this program. The ultimate control was standards, regardless if it's Wisconsin standards, if it's national standards, if it's Common Core standards, it doesn't matter. The ultimate control belongs with our school board. Our school board is the one who decides, yes, these textbooks may be bought. These purchases may be made. Hiring of staff is your responsibility. All of our board members are voted in, and at all times, parents, community, board members are always welcome in any of our buildings. You are free to come in at any point of the day to see what we are doing, to see what we are showing our kids, so you can see all of the wonderful things that they are doing and living every day. Common Core and the whole child asks that our kids enter school healthy. It asks that they experience a great physical and emotional safety within our buildings. We want our kids to be active daily, not only in school, but within the broader community. We are asking our kids to have personalized learning, and that comes from qualified and caring adults, and that each student is challenged academically. We're going to push students as hard as we can if they are ready for it. Finally, this came from Dr. Tony Evers, and this is my last slide, and he just said this on October 24th, and I quote, "The Common Core are a vast improvement over our old standards. And I ask everyone to read all of the Common Core standards to better understand what they are and what they are not. They are clear, concise, and internationally benchmarks expectations of what students should know and be able to do. They are a key component in our efforts to ensure that each child graduates well prepared for college and career."
Right now in the U.S., earning a high school diploma is not the same as being ready for college or career. 22% of American students drop out of high school. Of those that do graduate and go on to college, more than a third are unprepared. And 46% never get a degree because we didn't prepare them for success. Making matters worse, many kids don't even start with a level playing field. In many U.S. schools, students who look like they're top performers are actually way behind students in other cities or states who are graduating college ready. When everyone has different standards, there is no way to measure success. Our standards are outdated and inconsistent. It's time for a wake-up call to ensure all kids have a 21st century education so they can succeed in school and compete in our fast-paced, technology-driven world. That's why teachers, principals, and education experts have come together to create the Common Core State Standards. Their goal? Align expectations for what kids need to know to be ready after high school. New standards because your child deserves better. And you deserve the peace of mind that comes from knowing they are prepared. So keep on dreaming. Who knows how far they will go.
Tonight, Dr. Ritchie, and I first want to say that I'm here as a concerned citizen, but I'm also representing the Concerned Women of America. First and foremost, everybody in this room realizes that all of you and all of the teachers are excellent and superior at what you do. There's no question here that the argument against Common Core standards has anything to do with what it is that's in your hearts and what you're trying to accomplish all the time with these children. I had 9 children go through this school, and they all are very great kids, adults now, contributing into the society, and that's a thanks to the halls of this place. So that's not the problem with Common Core. The problem with Common Core standards, to make it simple in the little bit of time I have here, is that there's 2 major problems. One is the standards themselves. Okay, the standards that you adopted a couple of years ago when it came down the pipeline from the Secretary of Education here in the state were not even written yet. There's been no pilot programs and no cost analysis for you to even compare it to any other sort of standards that you might want to adopt. I don't think anybody can say that we don't need some standards. But do the standards have to be the one that you never even compared, the one that you never even had any evidence to show that they were going to be productive? And no cost analysis and how much it's going to cost. The first true, real study of costs are coming out on Wednesday from the Brookings Institute. And the state of Wisconsin is estimated somewhere well over $350 million. When we asked earlier this year administrators around the state how much it was going to cost, Dr. Ritchie was the only one that came up with any kind of a number. And I would just ask you, why is it that when we adopted these standards, which the teachers need for the tools so that they can excel the best, did we not compare them with other standards, such as the TIMS standards or the Massachusetts standards that have excelled the state of Massachusetts to number one in the country? And guess what? They're free. These are free standards. And now that the governor has turned around and realized that maybe the path we have gone in deciding to implement Common Core standards across the state was possibly a mistake, maybe not as high as they can be, because he did go on the record to say that Wisconsin can do better. Can we change? Yes, we can shift. There's experts out there that say that we can shift to TIMS or to Massachusetts or your own standards using the basework and the framework that we have that you've put into place here in a relatively short period of time. Some estimates are like about 3 weeks. So all of this is not for, I am not the expert. I am just a concerned citizen. I have 12 minutes of a DVD to show you of some other people who are far more, you know, experts in this field. It's a 30-minute DVD. We have 50 of them here tonight for anybody who would like them. Before I do that, though, the second thing that is terrible about Common Core standards, and Common Core standards, the idea behind it is nothing new. This is not just another set of standards. This is not just like No Child Left Behind or Race to the Top. This is federalizing education. This is like Social Security. Okay, this will not, you will not be, we most likely in 10 years from now will not be able to sit in this room and have a conversation like this, because you will not have the control that you have at this point. And you may not believe that, but that is the truth. There is the evidence to show. The experts that have been at the hearings around the state, Dr. Stotsky, Jim Milgram, they were the original people forming the Common Core standards, and they got off of them when they realized exactly how mediocre they were and what actually the intent was. So the major two problems: are we investing in a set of standards that are worth it? And number two is, are you all ready to risk federalizing education once and for all in this country, and what will that look like in 10 years from now? What kind of education will we be able to provide for our children here in a rural town when the dollars are controlled by the federal government? Do you think that you'll be able to get all the money that you need? Do you think Phelps and Three Lakes and all the money is going to be divvied up properly? Because that is, I think, what is totally at risk with Common Core standards. Do we need standards? Yes. Do I have any doubt that the people in this room and all these great teachers aren't going to continue to do a great job for the kids in this area? I don't think anybody doubts that. But is this wise, what we're doing, especially now? And isn't it interesting that we didn't know anything about it? Citizens, legislators, nobody knew. You knew a couple years as it was coming down the line, but nobody else knew, and that was by design. So 12 minutes of this DVD, I really appreciate it. Maybe just a closing statement. Thank you.
Education is quickly changing in the United States. It's hard for parents to keep up with what their children are learning in school, and it's even harder to understand the national trends in
in education and where they're taking our children and our country. I hope that today is the day that we will resolve to take ownership over the education of our children. So let's start by trying to understand what's happening in our public schools.
Hello, my name is Jane Robbins, and I'm with the American Principles Project. I have a disturbing story to tell, a story about the Common Core state standards, how they were foisted on the states by the federal government and by well-funded private interests in Washington. We need to realize that the Common Core will strip our states of their constitutional authority over education. Parents will no longer be able to control or even influence what their children are taught. The Common Core scheme will ultimately empower the federal government to control school curricula in violation of three federal statutes. Parents need to know how Common Core standards will ultimately narrow the curriculum and prepare our children to be cogs in a national industrial system rather than full citizens in a free republic. Taxpayers need to know how the Common Core leads to national testing that will impose substantial costs on state and local school budgets. Parents need to know how the massive student data tracking system will contribute to the loss of student and family privacy. Citizens need to understand how this new educational direction will gradually guide the next generation away from our free enterprise system and into a managed economy. All this is supposedly the price we have to pay to ensure that our children are better prepared to compete in the global economy. Join me as I explain what is a very real threat to the United States education system.
Jane, I don't know too much about the Common Core. Could you just start by defining what we are talking about exactly?
The Common Core State Standards Initiative is currently a set of national common K-12 content standards in English language arts and math, ideally to be adopted in all 50 states so that education will be standardized throughout the country. The supposed purpose of the Common Core is to impose rigorous standards so that our students will be better prepared for competing in the global economy and to allow comparison of student performance among states. Common Core standards have currently been adopted by 45 states and the District of Columbia.
So what's the problem with nationally standardized content standards? I heard that the states work together to create these standards.
Common Core proponents claim that Common Core was led by the states. But this simply isn't true. The real drivers of the Common Core were the same advocates of a national school curriculum who have been around for years in various guises. They tried and failed to impose a national curriculum in the past. For example, with the national history standards in the 1990s, which were so politically correct and anti-American that they were rejected by the U.S. Senate 99-1. The national curriculum advocates learned three things from past failures. First, don't call the curriculum standards national or federal. Second, impose them quickly and quietly before the people and their representatives find out about it. And three, don't start with a controversial subject such as history. Start instead with math and English.
Can you identify a few of these groups of people and why they seem so motivated to take over the curriculum standards in all 50 states?
This most recent effort of progressive education reformers is primarily connected with a nonprofit group in Washington, D.C. called Achieve, Inc., which wrote the national standards, with lavish funding from private foundations, especially the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They realized the need to make this look like a state-generated initiative, so they went to the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers, both of which are D.C.-based trade associations, and neither of which had a grant of legislative authority from states to write national school standards. But because the Common Core standards were created under their auspices, the proponents now claim that the effort was state-led. The real power here is the Gates Foundation, which has spent over $100 million helping create and propagate the standards, and has plans to spend many millions more. But over the long haul, with all the technology and new curriculum that this new educational paradigm requires, companies such as Microsoft will more than recover the money they have invested. There is a great deal of money to be made at the educational trough.
I'm trying to understand how these private groups could have so much influence over 50 states. Is the federal government involved in this?
Secretary of Education Arne Duncan is a huge proponent of Common Core, and under his direction, the Federal Department of Education has used its power of the purse to essentially bribe states to adopt the standards. In the spring of 2009, the infamous stimulus bill gave the Department of Education a $4.35 billion earmark, money to use however the department wanted. The department created the Race to the Top competition, whereby the federal government took our money and gave us the chance to compete to get some of it back. States could apply for Race to the Top grants, but to have a realistic shot at getting the money, they had to agree to adopt the Common Core standards and the national tests, the assessments, aligned with the Common Core, all sight unseen, because at that time the standards had not even been completed, and the testing component is still not complete. The Race to the Top application came out in November 2009, and completed applications were due only 2 months later. Now remember, at that time, the country was in a deep recession, and states were desperate for money. It's also important to note that between the months of November and early January, most state legislatures are not in session. So desperate state officials had to decide without consulting their legislatures whether to commit to the Common Core and all it entails in order to get Race to the Top money. The Common Core standards were finally released in June 2010, and states were given 2 summer vacation months to get their state school boards to sign off on the Common Core commitment, again, with no involvement by the legislature. The other way the federal government is promoting Common Core is through No Child Left Behind waivers. The U.S. Department of Education is encouraging states to adopt Common Core in order to qualify for a waiver from the most demanding provisions of No Child Left Behind.
It's obvious that these federal grants usurp legislative authority and make state control irrelevant. What about the national testing? What are the concerns associated with the testing aspect of the Common Core?
2 consortia of states have hired so-called testing experts to create national tests aligned with the Common Core. One is called the Smarter Balanced Assessment Consortium, and the other is the Partnership for Assessment of Readiness for College and Careers, better known as PARC, P-A-R-C-C. These will all be computerized tests, so school districts will have to acquire and maintain the technology necessary for testing all students in most grades multiple times per year.
Who's paying to develop these tests?
The U.S. Department of Education gave the 2 consortia $360 million for test creation. And once that money runs out, the states that are members of the consortium will have to assume the costs. These types of computer-driven tests are far more expensive than traditional testing, and there has not been a candid discussion on the ongoing costs this creates for taxpayers. Something to consider about the people developing these PARC and Smarter Balance tests. The PARC tests are being designed by the same group of progressive reformers that gave us the Common Core standards. With respect to Smarter Balanced, the most influential person there is a radical Stanford professor named Linda Darling Hammond, who has partnered with Bill Ayers, yes, that Bill Ayers, in the past on some of his education projects, and who is basically opposed to testing students at all. Under her direction, the Smarter Balanced test will probably lower the bar on student academic expectations and instead focus on subjective performance-based outcomes. So we ought to question whether these tests are even going to test the type of academic knowledge that students ought to have.
I've heard you say now a couple of times that states will not be able to change the content standards. What exactly do you mean by that, and how does that affect curriculum?
Common Core proponents claim that these are just standards, not curriculum, and states will be in charge of their own curriculum. But this claim is misleading at best. The point of standards is to drive curriculum. Standards say what should be taught in the classroom. The curriculum just adds the details. And we know that what's on the national test will very concretely dictate curriculum. The 2 testing consortia admitted in their applications for federal grants that they would use the money to develop curriculum models. And the U.S. Department of Education bragged about this when it made the grants. So, the inevitable result of the Common Core scheme will be a national curriculum.
Is this legal?
No. The U.S. Constitution leaves education policy to the states. Despite this, both parties have been trying to centralize educational control in Washington for years. Even so, Congress has passed 3 separate statutes prohibiting the U.S. Department of Education from supervising, directing, or controlling curriculum. By coercing states into Common Core and funding national tests that will dictate curriculum, the Obama administration is violating three statutes.
What exactly is a state committing to when it agrees to adopt Common Core?
By committing to Common Core, a state agrees to implement the standards word for word. It may not change anything, it may not delete anything. It may add a small amount of content, but no more than 15% of any content area. 15% doesn't sound like state taxpayers and parents have control to me, yet they still have to pay the bills while their voices are shut out of the process.
If states are locked into these content standards, what happens if parents or teachers determine that some aspect of Common Core isn't working in the classroom?
There will be no one to call. No one in the state, not the local school principal, not the superintendent, not the local school board, not the state school superintendent, not the legislators, not the governor, no one will have any power to change any standard. Which leads to a disturbing question. Who will have control over the standards in the future? To revise them if they aren't working in the classroom? Common Core is owned and copyrighted by the National Governors Association and the Council of Chief State School Officers. So what does this mean for parents? It means parents will have no way of knowing the identities and positions of the people in charge of the standards. We will truly have anonymous people controlling our children's education. This is education without representation.
Okay. I get the fact that this makes an end run around state control of education in total violation of that principle of federalism our founders gave us. But what about the standards themselves?
Common Core proponents claim the standards are rigorous and will make our students college ready. Well, not exactly. One of the drafters of the math standards admitted that the college they will prepare our children for is a non-selective community college, not a four-year university. At one point, the creators of Common Core claimed the standards were internationally benchmarked and that they were as rigorous as those in countries whose students score the highest on international tests. But the Common Core Validation Committee was never shown any evidence of this. And the Common Core website no longer even claims that the standards are internationally benchmarked. Instead, it now says they are informed by the standards of other countries, whatever that means. Let's look at the quality of the standards specifically. First, the math standards. Dr. James Milgram of Stanford University, the only mathematician on the validation committee, said that it's almost a joke that a student would be prepared for university-level math after having completed the Common Core curriculum. One problem is that Common Core moves Algebra 1 from 8th grade to 9th grade, which means it will be more difficult for most students to reach calculus in high school, as expected by selective universities. Another problem, it will teach geometry by an experimental method never used successfully anywhere in the world. And remember, a teacher who sees that this experiment isn't working will have no one to go to in order to get it changed. Other problems with Common Core's math standards led Dr. Milgram to conclude that by eighth grade, our students will be about 2 years behind those of the highest achieving countries. Moving on to the English Language Arts standards. This is where we see the really troubling philosophy behind Common Core. Dr. Sandra Stotsky, who served on the validation committee but refused to sign off on the English Language Arts standards because they were so inadequate, described them as empty skill sets that won't prepare students for authentic college coursework. From what she has seen of the standards and the drafter's commentary, she's afraid the reading level that will deem students college ready will be about seventh grade level. Even more troubling is Common Core's de-emphasis on studying classic literature in favor of reading non-fiction informational texts, such as technical manuals and brochures. One education publisher even includes teaching restaurant menus rather than literature. It's not clear exactly how much literature study is to be replaced by informational texts, but the creators of the English standards suggest at least 50% of the reading in English classes should be non-fiction rather than literature. And there are several problems with this. First, most English teachers in the country have not been trained to teach this kind of material, nor would the good ones want to. So those who don't quit in frustration will have to be retrained. Second, what little teacher training there has instructed teachers to treat our most important historical documents, such as the Gettysburg Address, as if they were just sentences on a page, without context and without cultural importance. However, the most serious problem is the philosophy behind this approach, the philosophy that children shouldn't be overeducated, shouldn't spend time studying something that won't give them practical assistance in their future jobs, that the point of education is to train children to be cogs in a government-managed economic machine, not to educate them to be informed, thinking citizens in a democratic republic, to be better human beings. That is what studying great literature can do for students, but that's what Common Core seeks to minimize. The education establishment, as well as the many vendors set to make money on Common Core through our tax dollars, have been lobbying teachers and local school systems for months with assurances that Common Core is the magic bullet to solve our education problems. But because the standards have been implemented so far primarily in the lower grades, where they are less objectionable, the teachers who will be the most adversely affected don't really know what they're in for. The big teachers unions, such as the National Education Association and the American Federation of Teachers, that are supporting Common Core are doing their members no favors.
It goes on with some more chapters. I do have some if you would like to watch it. I just ask that you would think and research a lot about what it is we're entering into here. Maybe some of the facts, some of the teachers there, you know, would not agree with everything. I'm sure that you believe that you're going to be able to excel these kids and continue to be one of the best schools in the state. But is that going to be able to be accomplished 10 years from now? If the bar is dropped and we're spending big money to adopt common standards, are we really going to be doing something wonderful for our kids, which is what these teachers need, with the, giving them the best tools, or are we going to be ending up doing another mistake, another lackluster federal program that is not going to bring us any more globally competitive than we are now? And so, truly, I think that yes, Wisconsin's a local control state, and you do have the control here, but hang on to it and think about what you're doing. Right now, all the legislators who knew nothing about this in January when we brought it to their attention are asking, what are the teachers saying? What are the administrators and all the school boards saying? And I totally understand that you would be totally into this. You guys have been working on it for 2 or 3 years and never thought that there was anything wrong with it. But is it the right thing that we're doing? Is this wise? Is this prudent? Is this going to be the best thing for our children if we don't have any local control? Is there anybody in this room that actually thinks the federal government is going to run education better than all of you here in this room? Is there anybody? So I would just ask that you would really consider and think. Right now, the last hearing is Wednesday in Wausau, and we really do need some people that are of your field to think and make some courageous, you know, maybe some courageous moves on it. If one district would just stand up and say, you know what, maybe we should have compared it. Maybe before we went and spent, you know, $250,000 or more of a taxpayer's dollars and pivoted our whole future of our district into a direction, we should have compared it with some other standards, with some other ideas. So that's all I really have to say. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for having me.
My husband and I are retired. We live in Conover, Wisconsin. We spend most of our time in Illinois. I have some handouts that I would like to give here. And this is something that I came out across years ago when my kids were going to school. Curriculum evaluation. What is success going to be looking like? Where has the program been implemented successfully in the past? What success benchmarks are set up by the district? If the program doesn't work well, at what point will it be reformed or removed? What is the cost to implement the system? On Saturday, I was at a conference, and I did speak with Jim Sturgis, who was involved in the Massachusetts effort to reform their education. It was 3 years. He said it was debating in public on a regular basis. 3 years. It was in the newspapers all the time. They get something done, people complain, they revise, they finally got something done, and they are number 6 in the world for math in 2011. So to me, that's a huge accomplishment, and it's something that at least this district could possibly consider looking at. Cost, we don't know what, like Kim said, the cost estimates are going to be coming out on Wednesday. I noticed that when Gayle was doing her presentation, everything was on the computer. there's 800,000 public school students here in this state. So if every student gets a new computer, maybe $500 per computer, that's $400 million. That's a lot of money. Then you're talking about the bandwidth. Then you're also talking about a help desk. After school, between 3 and maybe 10 p.m., if you have just a very small percentage of students calling into a help desk, you might need 200 people operating a help desk. Who's going to pay for that? Currently, my husband and I are retired. We pay over $3,000. Let me see, I think it was like over $3,000 a year ago, $2,500 last year because we have a tax decrease. Then because of the referendum, it's going to be over $3,000 just going to Northland Pines. My husband and I are retired. I need good roads. I really don't need all of this money going in for schools. I'm concerned that this is going to affect me, all of the thousands of people who have vacation homes up here. What are they getting for a vacation home? If they're paying thousands of dollars to Northland Pines and all of the other counties here too, they have no control. But the taxes are going to be going up because of the computers, the bandwidth, and the retraining for the teachers. So another question, number 6. How often will status updates be given on this program? Has a process been published for parents to challenge objectionable aspects of this problem? Kim's TBD stopped at when they were talking about data mining. That's a huge concern. I was talking with my cousin from California yesterday, and I mentioned Common Core, and her friend calls it Common Crap. And this lady said, I'm not sending my kids to public school in California, she's sending them to Christian school because of the intrusive questions that the teachers have to ask the children on behalf of their entire family. It's not your business to know voting records, how a family votes, what their religion is. It's not your business to know their family income. It's just not your business, but that's coming through, and that's in the state budget for Common Core. That was here in Wisconsin. For whatever reason, the legislature kept in the funding for that data mining. Has the district reviewed proven lower cost or free options? Tim's, Massachusetts, there's BASIC, there's KIPP. Bill Gates, you think about that, if he puts in $5 billion to get Common Core, that shows you that public education is up for sale by the highest bidder. He's got some of the deepest pockets in the world, and he stands to make tens of billions of dollars based on Common Core with computers, software, all of that. So I'm in favor of free enterprise, but I don't want to have to pay for his profit for everyone else's kids. I saw an awful lot of enthusiasm for education. I saw great teachers here, and I'm gratified by that. But I don't want it to be dumbed down. I want it to stay great. This morning, I just did a Google search. Parents Against Common Core, 42 million hits. That's a lot of hits. Local control. If you look at the other side of our curriculum evaluation, Karen Schroeder did call up the Wisconsin DPI. Yes, Wisconsin is a local control state. You don't have to do Common Core. You can pick your own curriculum. You can look at something else. You can, and you will not be jeopardizing your state funding. I think I've covered it all. So, thank you very much for your time. And I enjoy education. I just don't want to be paying more than I already am paying. You've got to have the cost estimates. And when Brookings Institute comes out on Wednesday with cost estimates, take a thorough look at that and then compare it to Tim's or Massachusetts. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
In reaction to what I heard, and I'm probably going to say a couple things that everybody's said already, but the one thing that sticks in my mind is trust. Why? Why are we trusting the feds? Why can't we do it on our own? Why do we have to do it right now? Why can't we wait a year? What have the feds done with education that we should go ahead and blindly trust them? The Department of Education was created in 1979. It was split off as a cabinet position in 1979. Since then, we've dropped to 25th in the world in math. We dropped 10 spots in high school and college graduation rates. We spend more than anybody in the world on education. We spend twice as much as we did 40 years ago, but the students aren't testing any smaller. So what does the federal education, Department of Education want for us? Why are we just gonna jump in and go ahead on what they tell us to do? Can't we sit and maybe wait a year or two? I've heard we got local control. We have terrific teachers, I can tell you. Steve Miller and John Hayes are both terrific. They would do what they're gonna do on their own if they had local control. In fact, I think they would probably meet tougher standards. We have great teachers here. Let them do what they have to do. We don't need the feds to control them. And they know what kids need to know here. It might be different than somewhere else. They can customize it to our area. Lastly, I mean, it was a great presentation on Common Core, but I wish I had heard something definitive. So there's really not one thing in there that you can put your hand on, put your finger on, and say, this is it. This test proves this. I mean, I'm sure that's what we heard about Race to the Top. We heard about No Child Left Behind. Those were failures. They weren't successes. If anybody thinks they're a success, I totally disagree with them. It goes all the way back to the new method of 60s. I don't know if anybody remembers that. What a failure that is. But historically, the feds have done nothing for us. The farther the control gets, the worse it gets. That's all. Thank you.
Well, that's gonna conclude our discussion here. I mean, I will take, and I know the board will too, we'll take a lot of the things that people brought here, and Kim has brought, Charlie, Shirley, and everybody in this room cares about the kids and about education. So that's one thing that this community really appreciates is all the people that come out and support the kids and support education like this. So we will review these things. We'll keep on top of things when the report comes out this week. We'll take a look at it. I certainly am interested in reading this, so I will be taking a look at that. But otherwise, we're going to move on to the rest of the agenda here.